Thank you. Good morning. It's good to see you all on this beautiful Sunday on Memorial Day weekend already. Can you believe it? Doug, we have a birthday. But I'd say she's probably camping. Elaine Zahns. Elaine Zahns' birthday is Saturday the 1st. So. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Elaine. Happy birthday to you. And also, here's your readings for today. And I wanted to put up a nice picture of Lake Erie to remind us that we're coming into the time of year when we really think about that lake out there. So we have a beautiful, beautiful thing to live by this lake. Also today, we are celebrating Trinity Sunday. Trinity Sunday. But right now, I would like to say a prayer, or have a prayer, a silent prayer for everyone, just to remember those who have died serving our country, and we want to think about those people because they really, their sacrifice is part of why we have our freedom. So let's right now take just a time for a silent prayer for those who have passed. Amen. And I would like to also do a prayer for the Trinity. Let's pray. O Triune God, what an exciting mystery we celebrate today, that you, our God, are three persons in one being. Your essence is so awesome, it is beyond our understanding. O Father, you adopted us as your children through the death and resurrection of your Son. O Holy Spirit, you gave us faith in Jesus through explosive power of the gospel. You testify that we are God's children, and you guarantee our inheritance of eternal glory with Jesus. Holy Trinity, your saving love overwhelms us. Keep us as your own, and each day move us to declare, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty." We ask this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, through all eternity. Amen. Take this time to turn around and give a wave hello to those who are watching online. It's good to have you with us today. I'm sure there are people who normally are out here in the pews that are watching us online right now. So, and also a special hello to Pastor Steve and Elaine, who very faithfully watch us on our YouTube video because they're 3 hours behind us. So we're very happy to always have them worshiping with us as well. And they love it when you turn around to wave because then they get to see you. So it makes them feel like they're right here. And that's a fabulous thing that the technology, I don't always like technology, but sometimes and technology is a good thing as well. So. If you would, please rise for our call to worship. Our call to worship is taken this week from Psalm 108, verses 1 through 5. My heart, O God, is steadfast. I will sing and make music with all my soul. Awake, harp and lyre. I will awaken the dawn. I will praise you, Lord, among the nations. I will sing of you among the peoples. In our response, for great is your love, higher than the heavens, your faithfulness reaches to the skies. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. Let your glory be over all the earth. Praise and honor be to Almighty God forever and ever. Amen. Please remain standing for our praise songs. would remain standing today for our prayer of confession. Let us bow our heads. Our Father, forgive our sins. Forgive the sins that we remember and the sins we have forgotten. Forgive our many failures in the face of temptation and those times when we have been stubborn in the face of correction. Forgive the times that we have been proud of our own achievements and those when we have failed to boast in your works. Forgive the harsh judgments we have made of others and the leniency we have shown to ourselves. Forgive the lies we have told to others and the truths we have avoided. Forgive us the pain we have caused others and the indulgence that we have shown ourselves. Lord God, have mercy on us and make us whole. Now, if you would, please take this time for silent prayer. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power to change our lives and make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant given in Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen. And if you would please say with me today our assurance of pardon. Hear the good news. Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life has gone, a new life has begun. In the name of Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen. And if you would open your hymnals to hymn number 3, Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. Another one, hymn number 740. I'm shaking you up this morning. Joy unspeakable.
Thank you.
Please be seated.
The distinctive Christian claim is that God is love. A Jew or a Muslim would say, God loves. God loves the world. That's true, and we say the same thing. But the radical Christian difference is, we say that God is love. In other words, love is not just something that God does. It's who God is. And the claim that God is love is the ground for the Trinity. Chesterton said this, a lot of people are uneasy with the doctrine of the Trinity. It seems like medieval mumbo jumbo. But everybody gets enthusiastic about the claim that God is love. In fact, those two claims are the same. If you say God is love, you have to mean that within the very being of God, there's a play of a lover, a beloved, and the love that they share. Yes, God loves the world, that's true, but more primordially, God is love. And therefore, we have to say there's a play of one, two, and three within the one God of Israel. Here's the amazing thing. John, Peter, Paul, all of them were proclaiming the God of Israel. Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is God alone. No Christian wants to deny for a second the unity of God. We reflect it, by the way, in our creed. We believe in one God. That's our version of, Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God is God alone. But yet, this one God of Israel has now revealed himself to be a play of lover, beloved, and love. We know that because Jesus, the Son, who was sent by the one he called Father, is himself God. No, Abraham was sent, Isaiah was sent, Jeremiah, okay, but they were sent just as human prophets. Jesus was sent, all right, but yet he is God. Therefore, within God himself, there's some play of sender, sent, and the love in which the sent was sent. I think that's the ground for the Christian claim about the Trinity.
Bishop Barron is a wonderful Roman Catholic priest. He's actually one of the main people that's behind The Chosen in helping keep biblical. He's a wonderful theologian. If you ever get a chance to see his videos on different subjects or watch a television program with him on it, give it a try, because he's a really wonderful and gifted speaker for God. Malachi 3:10 tells us, bring the whole tithe into the storehouse, that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty, and see if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing that there will not be room enough to store it. While we enjoy this next piece of music, let us consider how we may offer our time, our talents, or any other good gifts that we have received from the Lord to benefit and further God's will for his creation. Your tithes and offerings may be placed in the plate at the back of the sanctuary as you're leaving today. Thank you. Please rise. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these gifts that you have given to us, all these blessings that you have bestowed upon us to be your servants. Lord, we pray now that you give us your blessings on these offerings that have been placed in the plate today, and that we may use them best for your creation. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. Let us pray. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. Amen.
If I may take a moment of liberty, Doug's playing is so beautiful that even the birds outside sit and listen attentively. We're so blessed to have you. This is a reading from Psalm 29, which may be found on page 866 of your Pew Bible. Ascribe to the Lord, you heavenly beings. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in the splendor of his holiness. The voice of the Lord is over the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord thunders over the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is powerful. The voice of the Lord is majestic. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedars. The Lord breaks in pieces the cedars of Lebanon. He makes Lebanon leap like a calf, Syrian like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord strikes with flashes of lightning. The voice of the Lord shakes the desert. The Lord shakes the desert of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord twists the oaks and strips the forests bare, and in his temple all cry, glory. The Lord sits enthroned over the flood. The Lord is enthroned as king forever. The Lord gives strength to his people. The Lord blesses his people with peace. May God bless this reading of his holy word.
A reading from Romans 8:12 through 17, which may be found on page 1757 in your Pew Bible. Please listen, this is wonderful. Therefore, brothers and sisters, we have an obligation, but it is not to the flesh to live according to it. If you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if you, by the Spirit, you put to death the misdeeds of the body, and you will live. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. I'm going to read that again. For those who are led by the Spirit of God are the children of God. The Spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the Spirit you receive brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Now, if we are God's children, then we are heirs, and heirs of God and co-heirs with Christ, if indeed we share in his sufferings in order that we may also share in his glory. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Jill and Priscilla. And I also want to thank Gary for being Elder of the Month as well. For those of you that are Elder of the Month for June or Deacon of the Month for June, you're up next week. So I don't actually know who those two people are right now, Neil and Emily. Okay, you're up next week, so thank you for your month of service as well. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And those are the words of the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. They are some of the most beautiful words that you will ever read in the Bible, because they tell us so much about God's saving power and what Jesus' mission is. These words form the first passages of the Gospel of John, and they are telling about the divine nature of Jesus that the Apostle John wants all of us to know about Christ right from the very start. In the last 6 months, we've been hearing about Jesus from his birth, to his prophecies, to his ministry, to his death, his resurrection, his ascension, and his foretelling of the Spirit of God being sent to the believers. All of these things culminate today on Trinity Sunday. The Trinity of God is not an event in Scripture, but it is the meaning of it all. The fullness of God rests in the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Christians do not worship multiple gods or three gods, as some would believe we do. Now, let me repeat that, especially if somebody's listening online who thinks differently. Christians do not believe in multiple gods or in three gods, but in one God, just one. We believe in God the Father, God Almighty that exists as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. This belief binds all Christians together, and if someone claims to be a Christian but doesn't claim the truth of the Holy Trinity, then they lie outside of Christianity. And you would be wise not to listen to anything that they have to say about matters of faith. Now, I don't want you to take that as what I said to be a reason to mistreat someone or to demonize them. They may be just be misguided individuals or have lost their way, but I want you to be very careful about their theology or their teachings. Maybe they would be a stumbling block in your faith, or maybe they have been placed in your life so that you may witness the truth of Christ to them. The Lord does work in mysterious ways, mysterious but wondrous. Mystery is a word that our Roman Catholic brothers and sisters use often in their writings about God and His ways. His ways truly are a mystery. How do we explain everything about God and what He does in a way that we can fully understand? The short answer is, we can't. It's a mystery. Or we say, God works in mysterious ways. These statements are true, and they're not a dodge from a question, but just a fact. In matters of faith, we often feel the truth, even if we can't explain it. I love my wife, but I can't prove it or understand it in the truest sense of the word. But it is not made up, it is a truth. When we love someone, we can't often explain it, but that doesn't make it any less real. Being a Christian can be like that sometimes. I can't always explain why I feel the way I do about my faith, but I know that I believe. And God is continually at work strengthening that belief. Now, this can be a bit simplified, but if you were standing outside with a small child, and you can both feel the breeze on your faces, and the child asks you, "What is that feeling on my face?" "The wind," you say. "What is the wind?" asks the child. "The wind is the wind," you say. What else can you say? How do you explain the wind to a small child, other than naming what we feel? You can't see it. You can't taste it or smell it. But you can often hear it. And you can definitely feel it, so you know it exists. It can be that same way with the Holy Trinity. We can't always explain it, but we can sense it. And we can see it in all of creation. We can see it and read about it in Scripture. But it's still not easy to explain. I have often used water as an example to at least explain the forms of the Trinity. Water comes in three distinct forms: liquid, gas, and solid. We know that water can be in these three forms, and we know that all three forms are different, but we have no problem accepting that they are all H2O, water. God is God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Three distinct forms or persons, but still one God. One of the big differences, though, in our analogy is that water can take these three forms, but they cannot be all three forms at one time. God can and is all three at once. Now, that's hard to wrap our brains around that. But as I said before, we can feel it before we can explain it. God gives us that. That's called faith. Listen to this passage of Scripture from John 14. that we talked about last week. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there is many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really know me, you will know my Father as well. And from now on, you do know him, and you have seen him. Philip said, Lord, show us the Father, and that will be enough for us. Jesus answered, don't you know me, Philip? Even after I have been among you such a long time, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? Don't you believe that I am in the Father and that the Father is in me? The words I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority. Rather, it is the Father living in me who is doing his work. Believe me when I say that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or at least believe on the evidence of the works themselves. Very truly, I tell you, whoever believes in me will do the works that I have been doing, and they will do even greater things than these, because I am going to the Father. And I will do whatever you ask in my name, so that the Father may be glorified in the Son. You may ask me for anything in my name, and I will do it. Hence, when we pray in Jesus' name, this is why we do this. If you love me, keep my commands, and I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate to help you and be with you forever, the Spirit of truth. The world cannot accept him, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him. For he lives with you and will be in you. I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you. Before long, the world will not see me anymore, but you will see me. Because I live, you also will live. On that day, you will realize that I am in my Father, and you are in me, and I am in you. Whoever has my commands and keeps them is the one who loves me. The one who loves me will be loved by my Father, and I too will love them and show myself to them. Then Judas, not Judas Iscariot, said, But Lord, why do you intend to show yourself to us and not to the world? Jesus replied, Anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. Anyone who does not love me will not obey my teaching. These words you hear are not my own. They belong to the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken while still with you. But the Advocate, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and will remind you of everything that I have said to you. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. And I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not be afraid. You heard me say that I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you loved me, you would be glad that I am going to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. Now, this passage of Scripture says a lot, but it also explains why Christians feel the way we do about the Holy Trinity. Jesus refers to specific identities, the Father, the Spirit, and he refers to himself, the Son. He also tells us that he is one with the Father, and that the Father will send the Spirit in Jesus' name to those who believe. Pentecost, last week. He also says that the Father is greater than himself. Now, this can be very confusing to some people, and it is often revealed to us as we gain more faith. How can Jesus say that he and the Father are one, but then say that the Father is greater than he is? The answer is forms or persons. Think about one of our favorite hymns, and we sang it just this morning. And the words say, "Holy, holy, holy, Lord God Almighty, God in three persons, blessed Trinity." There's an old visual symbol that is very well known to the church, and it was from medieval Europe. You can actually see it's a stained glass picture of it in the screen today. It's called the Shield of the Trinity. It's an equilateral triangle with the Father at one point of the triangle. In the picture, you can see it says Pater. Okay, that's Father. So you see that on the left part of the screen. The Son on another point, and the Holy Spirit on the last point. You can see Filius on the right, that's the Son, and Spiritus down at the bottom. In the center of the triangle is God, Deus, which you see up there, okay? God's in the center. This is a representation that God is all three persons, but each of the persons is not doing the task of the others in the same way. So, you see Father on the left, Son on the right, Spirit on the bottom. You see between Father and Son, it says non est, okay? And you see the same thing going from Son to Spirit and from Spirit to Father. So it means the Father is not the Son, okay? The Son is not the Spirit, and the Spirit is not the Father. But in the center, you see Father in the left corner, and in going down to the center, it says Est, okay? That means the Father is God from the Son is God, and the Spirit is God, okay? This is the representation that we use to kind of help us with this. Now, remember what Jesus said, "The Father is greater than I," meaning that Jesus, as the Son, is sent in the flesh to be as one of us. The Son humbles himself to become human so that he may die to save us from death. The Father cannot die because of his nature. And he raises Jesus from death to life again. The Father also sends the Holy Spirit to live within us. Another nature altogether different from the Father and the Son. You have to remember that Jesus is still alive to this day. He was resurrected to life again. He's not dead. Okay, so he can't come live inside of us in a physical body, okay? So the Spirit of God comes to live within us. The symbol then shows us that even though the persons of God are different in function, they are all God equally. Thus, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. That's why it's written that way, okay, when we read different things. It's so we can understand that. Now, I know that this is a weighty exercise, and believe me, Sometimes when I talk about this, I feel like I just took the SATs. But it is crucial in our faith to have an understanding of the Trinity and to be able to reasonably explain how we believe if asked when someone is searching for God. You may not be able yet to give an answer on how or why you believe the way that you do, and that's okay. Because as I said before, not all things are provable by scientific means. But that doesn't make them any less real. Refer people like this, if they have questions, to a pastor, such as myself, if you don't feel comfortable with that question. Know this, though. The God that we worship is the one and only God of all that is and ever shall be. God is one, not multiple, but also not bound to an existence such as us, and therefore able to exist as one God with three distinct persons, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. All three natures in one holy an all-powerful God that loves each and every one of us as his children and heirs of his kingdom. Now, what a comfort to know that in a universe where we often feel so insignificant, we are loved and treated like the special people that we are by our Creator and our Almighty Father. What an honor. And I mean an absolute honor to be known and loved by that blessed Trinity. Thanks be to God. Amen. If you would please rise for hymn number 9, Glorify Thy Name.
Deacon's prayer for the people. God our Father, who creates all that is and all that will be, We thank you for always being with us and caring for our needs and well-being. You promise that where two or more gather in your name, you are with us and hear us. Now, Lord, hear our prayer for those close to us. We pray for the Wells family, Joanne and Jim Bindeman, Fred Johnson, John Banks, Scott Bain, Andrew Fisher, Joe Manuela, David Horniak, Joe Cassano, Cassie Black, Reverend Rick Sipris, Paul Togg, Betty Ann Johnson, Marlo Markoff, Stan Lesneski, Stephanie Krigish, Neil Dirchman, Joyce Askins, Bibi Kai, Nick Rains, Sean and Tracy Lyons, Bob Lemer, Felicia Archer, Monica March Ross, Connie Carey, Ryan Onderko, Joe and Patty Kuna, the Matlack family, Sarah Cornelius, L. Alster, Greg Kars, Florence Brower, Sharon Gallagher, Greg Kinney, Lois Garfield, Paul Jensen, Aggie Roach, excuse me, Joyce Shannon McLean, Mary Thompson, Carl Walthick, and those who were affected by the war, Adam and A.J. Brine, Jake Robleski, Toby Charlton, Jonathan Skelton, and other members of our armed forces. Almighty God, may we be to others what they need, a body to work when others cannot, a heart to love those who are forgotten, a shoulder to console those whose soul is in need, a smile to brighten the most somber of your children, and a mouth to proclaim your love. Strengthen and guide our congregation to know your will and be of service to our committee. Help us to be a beacon of light, gathering and leading your people to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
The opportunity to eat and drink with Christ is not a right bestowed upon the worthy, but a privilege given to the undeserving. All who come in faith, repentance, and love to the Lord's table are offered the bread and the cup. Regardless of their age, their understanding, their denominational faith, or whether they've been baptized or not. Remember that those of you who are watching us online, you are welcome to partake in this communion with us. All you need is juice or wine and bread or crackers and to just follow along. If you would please rise for hymn number 460, let us break bread together.
Thank you.
Please be seated. Brothers and sisters, this is the Lord's table. People will come from all over the earth to sit together in the kingdom of God. Our Savior invites those who trust in him to share this feast which he has prepared, the joyful feast of the people of God. According to Luke, when the risen Lord was at the table with his disciples, he took the bread and he blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened and they recognized him. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Almighty Father, you spoke the world into being. Your word became flesh in Jesus Christ. By your Spirit, you made us your people. When we were lost in sin, you found us, sending us your prophets and even your own Son. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with the choirs of angels and with all the faithful of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Now, let us pray for God's rule on earth as Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Holy Father, we give you thanks that on the night of his arrest, Jesus took the bread. And after giving thanks to you, he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, This is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me. The gifts of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. The body of Christ given for you, take and eat. The blood of Christ shed for you, take and drink. Let us pray. Holy Spirit, you have filled us with your life. Christ, our Savior, you have embraced us in your love. God, our Father, you have fed us with your grace. Now send us out into your beloved world to share your life, your love, and your grace with all. Blessing and honor and glory to you, holy, holy, holy Lord. So today I charge you to go out into the world knowing that the Holy Trinity of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are in your corner. Receive them all into your lives in every possible way, and let the light of the Trinity shine out through you for all to see, so that they too will find what you have found: God's love, His mercy, His grace, and His eternal reward. Now receive this blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May the Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace today, this week, and forevermore. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.